That's a name neutral right there. It is in my contract not to sing. That's why that was an instrumental. Welcome.
Yes, thank you so much.
Welcome to the Manassas Symphony Orchestras. One more time, it's from ABBA to Zeppelin. We have such an amazing program for you today. I was even able to drag my kids out here. They said, what's going on? I said, we're going to the symphony. And I said, yeah. And they said, we're going to hear Led Zeppelin. They said, who? I said, we're going to hear Bruno Mars. They went, all right! So we're going to have fun today. This is my second time here, and I'm so thrilled and honored to be asked back. Last year, I was not called host, I was called the DJ. And I like that title, so I'm going to try and keep it as that title. So I'm your disc jockey today. And a couple things I want to tell you before we begin. Today, you're going to be entertained by 70 magnificent musicians. Let's have a round of applause for them. Don't embarrass them, but apparently, through some accident, they're all wearing the same shirt. And that's, you know, it just happens that way. These are all volunteers. What we have here are music teachers, community musicians, once pro musicians, that are all volunteering their time to entertain you guys and also to have an organization that allows exceptional musicians of, say, high school age to sit in a symphonic setting. And it is wonderful for the community and for the musicians. And they require support, and they deserve support, which is why I'd like to remind you that there will be 4 concerts this season at the Hylton Performing Arts Center. You can actually buy your season ticket at the festive yellow table right over there. He's waving. And if you buy your tickets today for the season, you'll get a complimentary mug. Can we see the mug, gentlemen? There it is, right there. It holds all beverages, alcoholic and otherwise. If you've already purchased your season ticket and you have not gotten the mug, they will give you one if you show up there. So how about that? How about that, huh? All right. The program today, one more time, it's from ABBA to Zeppelin, and we start with one of the great American composers and one of the architects of the great American songbook. He was born Jacob Gershowitz in 1898 in Brooklyn. And amazingly to find out this man only lived to be 38 years old. And he made those 38 years count. I'm talking, of course, about George Gershwin. And he wrote songs that have been on people's minds for 100 years. Songs like Sly, Lady Be Good, I Got Rhythm, they can take that away from me. He wrote 2 operas, he wrote Porgy and Bess, he wrote Blue Monday, and orchestral pieces like American in Paris, which would eventually become a movie by Gene Kelly, beautiful Technicolor, your kids will hate it, and Rhapsody in Blue, which is one of my favorite pieces of all time. He was popular on Broadway, Hollywood. He was a pop writer, and he actually received the Congressional Medal of Honor, one of the few musicians to ever receive it, in 1985. Let us open our program, ladies and gentlemen. This is Gershwin by George.
Thank you.
Have not heard of, but they did become Journey. They really sort of excel from about 1978 to 1987 with 18 top 40 hits. And whether you like them or not, they will always be a part of our pop culture, whether it's Rodney Dangerfield dancing to them in Caddyshack, or Glee covering them in the show Glee, or Don't Stop Believin' in the final episode of The Sopranos, who nobody knows how it ended, but the song was played. And also, know this, Don't Stop Believin' is the most downloaded 20th century song in all of iTunes. And so everyone knows it, and you're going to hear it one more time today. So please welcome the sounds of everyone's favorite arena band with the rotating lead singer. This is the sounds of Journey.
Thank you.
symphonic piece with that much cowbell in it. I love a cowbell. Loving that. All right, now moving on. This is going to be a treat, and this is the one that I'm probably most excited to be here today. This artist was called, at birth, Peter G. Hernandez. And by age 4, he was an Elvis impersonator in Honolulu. Now, that's not the basis for a great show business story. I don't know what it is. But his name is Bruno Mars. He is wickedly talented. In the day of auto-tune and people sort of faking their way through music, Bruno Mars never fails to put on a great show. But he's asked who influenced him. Listen to this list of people that he listened. Michael Jackson. Michael Jackson's father-in-law, Elvis Presley. Jimi Hendrix. Sly Stone. Santana. George Clinton. Coldplay. And Little Richard. And that's a very disparate group of ingredients, but the result is something incredible. He's a Grammy Award winner, he's a Billboard Award winner, he's an AMA Award winner, and a Super Bowl halftime performer. From the album Unorthodox Jukebox, this is Treasure by Bruno Mars. Washington, D.C., 1899. And you know, we actually started his career and had success in the D.C. area, which means it's very likely he played concerts in Virginia and Maryland and probably right here in Manassas. But the money was not in Manassas, and that's why I can pull myself. But what he did is he went to Harlem and started as the house band at the legendary Cotton Club. And from there he went to Europe, and his music spread worldwide. He is considered a pivotal figure in the world of jazz. But one thing about Duke Ellington, he didn't call his music jazz. He just called it American music. And he performed for over 50 years. He garnered over 12 Grammy Awards, and he left us with an amazing musical legacy. He passed away in 1974, but his music lives on, and you will hear it right now. Here are some of the greatest songs from Duke Ellington. Ladies and gentlemen, Sir Duke.
Thank you.
musical selection, this next group featured is the best thing to ever come out of Sweden. It's even better than IKEA because they arrive on our shores fully assembled. They didn't need an Allen wrench, none of it all. They go by the names of, oh God, I hope I get this right. Agneta Holtzgaard, Bjorn Holdeus, Benny Anderson, Anna Fry Leinstrad. And what they did is they took the first letters of their first names and put them together and called the band ABBA, A-B-B-A, which is a better name than Agneta Bjorn Benny Anderson. And they performed in Stockholm in 1972. Now this is a five-year-old statistic, but I want you to try and wrap your head around this. As of 2010, worldwide, ABBA has sold 375 million records. Yeah, that's second only to a band called the Beatles, and they did pretty good too. They had 21 hit singles, a Broadway show, and a movie called Mamma Mia, the Movie, which is, I guess, to set it aside from Mamma Mia, the restaurant. I don't know, but it's Mamma Mia, the Movie, and it was great because it allowed us to hear singing from people you don't normally hear singing from. And today we have a medley for you of Mamma Mia, SOS, and Dancing Queen. Ladies and gentlemen, the Manassas Symphony Orchestra.
Thank you.
Now, this may shock you, but I've never been a member of a symphony orchestra. I know, it's shocking, but I think I've got this figured out, is that the end of the song is if you play good, the gym lets you stretch your legs. Is that what it is? Yeah. I want to call attention, the electric violin, that was Matt Best. Matt, great job. So cool. So cool. And we will be featuring Matt Best on our next selection as well. Now, this is one of my favorite rock and roll stories ever, so I'll try to keep it as brief as possible. You all heard of the band The Yardbirds, right? And they were a blues-influenced British invasion band in the 1960s. And a lot of people came through The Yardbirds. Even Eric Clapton played briefly with The Yardbirds, but they disbanded in 1968. When The Yardbirds disbanded, they had a young guitarist named Jimmy Page. He said, wait, I'm not done yet. I want to keep playing with The Yardbirds. So he tried to form a band, and he was going to call it The New Yardbirds. And he was going to bring in a superstar lineup of musicians. And they were going to call themselves the New Yardbirds. Except he couldn't use the word Yardbirds because it was owned by the record company. So he had to come up with a new name. Meanwhile, he's telling everyone about this great idea for this new band. It's him and a whole bunch of very talented musicians, a super group. And they said, well, that's going to go over like a lead balloon, meaning it would fail. And they changed balloon to another inflatable object, a Zeppelin. And they called themselves Led Zeppelin. And it turned out they were quite successful. So they're record companies. They pretty much invented what we know as heavy metal music today, although their music is mostly based in blues and, believe it or not, folk music. They really sort of, they're a game changer, Led Zeppelin. And we're going to hear three from Led Zeppelin today. We're going to hear Rock and Roll, Cashmere, and Stairway to Heaven. And when you woke up this morning and I said, hey, you know what's going to happen today? You're going to hear an orchestra play Cashmere. You'd say, you're crazy. Well, it's happening right before your very eyes. Featuring Matt Best on the electric violin, here's the Manassas Symphony Orchestra getting the lead out. I say Satchmo, you know who I'm talking about? Louis Armstrong, right? But what does the word Satchmo mean? It goes back to when he was a kid and he had a big mouth. Something I would know nothing about. But it actually is sort of a compressed phrase for satchel mouth. They were saying he had a mouth as big as a suitcase. And so that's why they called him Satchmo, and now you know. He was an amazing trumpet player. If you ever heard him sing, you never forgot it. And he invented a way of singing scat that sort of set the bar a lot higher for everyone else who ever tried to sing scat. But not just an amazing musician, but he came up through the ranks at a time when there was much separation in our country. And he was one of the true great crossover artists. He kind of helped blur the line between black entertainers and white entertainers, because everybody loved Louis Armstrong, who was not very political. And he wasn't really outspoken about it. But what he did spoke volumes. And if that wasn't impressive enough, he also charted a number one record right in the middle of Beatlemania. No one could do that. In February of 1964, when the Beatles had, I think, 18 songs on the top 40, and the number one was a little song called Hello Dolly. You will hear that today, along with What a Wonderful World, the St. Louis Blues March, and When the Saints Go Marching In. Ladies and gentlemen, the music of Old Satchel Mouth.